Okay, good evening and welcome. This is the final class in the first series, fractalu.com. I'm Dan Winter. This class is entitled The ET Origins, The Serious Extraterrestrial Origins of Biology and DNA and Religion on This Planet. And we're going to start with a little tribute to Star Wars, The Force Awakens, by putting context to this in terms of Djedi physics. First, I want to say that my particular view of the ancient history, extraterrestrial history, it's perfectly fair to say it could be speculative. I personally worked with and came to know a lot of people who worked in this field of ancient and extraterrestrial history, including Andre Puharik and Alex Collier, the Andromedan folks, and knew a lot of the people involved in the research on ancient ET history, Ghost Wolf, Robert Morningsky, many people. So I came to be personally involved with a lot of this work. And the point I want to make about that is I don't consider this version of the history story to be obligatory in any way. I'm not selling a particular history story or version of history. I am very impressed at the way so many of these serious sources on extraterrestrial history agree with each other. And I think the level of agreement from ancient myth to modern researches is so great that it could be very compelling. But again, I think what particular view you have of the ET history story is not so critical. What I am selling and pushing very hard, however, is a science lesson. I consider the science lesson to be obligatory, actually. And the science lesson could be summarized as raising the Djed. I mean, igniting your blood. I mean, getting enough charge in your aura to make you a Djedi, to make you sustainable, to create a vehicle with your aura, which is phase coherent enough to enable you to lucid dream and therefore take memory through death, to essentially be plasma projective enough in the sense of a Djedi Knight, perhaps, to be sustainable. And so the trick to accrete, acquire this grace, which tonight we're going to call May the Force Be With You, that is a science lesson. And that science lesson, I actually do think, is obligatory. The reason it's obligatory, first of all, is if you get a coherent large aura, it is the foundation of immune health, heart rate variability, harmonic inclusiveness. So a coherent aura is essential to a coherent immune system. Is my voice garbled, or are you hearing me okay? Perhaps if I talk a bit slower. Oh, good. Okay. Good. Okay. Good. So hopefully the bandwidth is okay. I will try to speak slowly and articulately. So the point being that one of the main reasons that I choose to teach my view of the history lesson is to push the science lesson, which is to learn the hygiene to have the force be with you. And I believe that's a serious science lesson for how the body accretes charge. So that's, and by the way, I also believe that's a turning point in the galactic history story where we say DNA in the blood is ignited. We call it fusion in the blood. And that is the web article for tonight's conversation, fractalfield.com/fusion-in-the-blood. And the two PDFs for tonight's conversation are at the top there. I put the links in the chat window. So that's the reason we're telling this history story, is to motivate and excite even the young people about learning the science lesson. So the second thing I'd like to say from a graduate study of University of Detroit, in addition to electrical engineering and psychophysiology, it was a very Jesuit institution, and we learned there what you might call the psychoanalysis of history, Jesuit style. And therefore, we studied things like, of course, Carl Jung, and we had strong views about what Carl Jung meant by a collective unconscious or the communion of saints. And I believe that that refers to a particular kind of electric field called a phase conjugate dielectric. Good, I'm glad you're hearing better, Gareth. Sometimes connection issues. At least the sound is acceptable, hopefully. So the point being that the science of what makes the collective unconscious available to you says, as Luke Skywalker is, you know, underground and or in a swamp forest in the midst of lots of biology and living things, he's learning to deal with and attract the force. My view is that Luke Skywalker could not have learned how to attract the force, the charge, in a metal building with steel and aluminum and electrosmog and bad air, because the very nature of having the force be with you is this physics of the living cold plasma, I call phase conjugate dielectric implosive charge, the self-aware charge which participates in biology, which is generated, we believe, by a perfect collapse wave, and that implosive collapse wave, phase conjugate negentropic collapse, is the title and subject of my book, fractalfield.com, Origins of Biologic Negentropy. And so the equation on the cover there is the physics which is behind all of these conversations about may the force be with you. How to attract the force is literally to implode and attract the charge. And the other thing about the psychoanalysis of history was, you know that when, let's see, was it Otto Rank wrote Hero with a Thousand Faces, or Joseph Campbell wrote The Flight of the Gander Through the Ages. In each case, they were saying, or The Myth of the Birth of the Hero is another example, they were saying that the face of the hero through history is always the same, and that it is archetype for the evolution of the human psyche. Well, yes, true. And that, for example, the Jesus story as a kind of sun god or sun king, we know is preceded by perhaps at least a half a dozen other major spiritual traditions that came before the Jesus story, which all involved crucifixion and a sun god. So again, we have this archetype for what it is to be the Anu, Anunnaki or Anakin, Anukin, which is to actually have the kind of coherent plasma that can penetrate and be, inhabit a star, to be a sun god. And so this is more than archetype, it's instruction. And so then if we start applying this to modern myths like Star Wars and Star Trek and Dune, we see that this recurrent myth survives history. And we're going to talk about the archetype of the Anunnaki family, the father Anu, the sons Enki and Lil, as being a sort of the archetype characters of this ancient story. Enki and Enlil are called fish god and snake god in Australia. They're a universal archetype. And Enki in Dune, for example, is Muad'Dib. And waking up to find his father is half machine is Harkonnen. And Enki in Star Wars is Luke Skywalker, waking up to find that his father is half-machine Darth Vader. And in each case, there is a recurrent truth behind the myths that actually catch fire. And that's why it is relevant to talk about these myths and see where the truth is, not just historically, but tonight where the truth is scientifically in these myths. So with that in mind, let's do a bit of Djedi physics for the moment. We know that Phyllis Schlemmer had a group in UK, a kind of a channeling group, in which they worked at length on the Orion history. And it's well known that Gene Roddenberry of Star Trek learned many of the themes of the Orion history, which became Star Trek. And we're about to talk about some of the physics from Star Trek in a moment. And also there were Alex Collier, who wrote so much in the Andromedan story, and his contact, supposedly. And I came to know him quite well. It was very helpful to me, actually. And, of course, Andre Puharic and the whole story of the Nine was there with that group in UK. And I knew Andre Puharic for many years. And that's the subject of Phyllis Schlemmer's book, The Only Planet of Choice, in which she explains how she inspired the Orion history in Roddenberry's work. So there is, again, a recurrent theme. So with that in mind, let's talk about some of the physics. So what in Star trek is called a warp drive appears to correspond very accurately to what's described in the Kosky-Frost experiments. And the PDF is at fractalfield.com/propulsion. And basically, there was a quartz crystal cube, which when triggered by a phase conjugate pump wave, as in Tom Bearden's work and the equation on the cover of my book, that quartz crystal cube vibrated and generated 800 times its own weight in lift or propulsion. Very well documented. And we would credit Bill Donovan, now Elizabeth, for his extensive work on this Kosky-Frost experiment. And Bill even noted how unusual it was that if you research this this particular issue Science and Invention magazine, 1927 issue, you will find that someone, presumably the secret government of the U.S., went to so much trouble to remove that issue from every university lending library in the country. So somebody went to a lot of trouble to hide this physics of how a conjugate crystal produces gravity. Interestingly, the phase conjugate crystal ideal would be a lithium niobate, and in Star Wars, I believe that's called, or in Star Trek rather, it's called the dilithium crystals. So you see this relationship. And actually, the concept of warping space has to do with the fact that the Z or helical axis of the quartz crystal is a helix. It's called a rotation of the plane of polarized light by refringence. So the long axis, the Z axis of a quartz crystal, is a helix, a slinky. That's what makes it piezoelectric like DNA. The point being that then rotates the phase conjugate wave, and rotating a phase conjugator is what produces lift. That's a classic cachet with the rotating monoatomics producing lift as well. And this concept then that the local space is bent, because the local space time is defined only by rotation, and if suddenly that rotation is embedded in a helix that it's itself rotating and compressing, that relative difference between the rotating helix and your local rotation frame of reference, that's called a warp factor, and it can move you from place to place. Interestingly, also with both the warp drive and the impulse power, that you can generate enough inertia in your own frame that you can take your inertial frame with you, which means if you get enough inertia in your own frame, you do not have to feel the turn. And we see so many of these ET craft making sharp turns at high velocities. And then we're going to talk about impulse power. And for impulse power, we're going to use the way in which a liquid was rotated in a spiral on a torus to make the Vimana fly. We believe in the Vimana, which the Nazis then studied to build the Nazi Bell. So the Nazi Bell was, we believe, used a similar principle as was Schauberger's repulsing, where the high inertial liquid, in the case of the ancient Vimana, we think it was mercury, if you pump it in high volume on a torus, you have translation of vorticity and you produce lift. You can see that sometimes if there's a knot in the high volume water hose of a fire truck, that if the slip knot gets in that fire truck at the right angle, suddenly the whole water hose will start lift up off the ground. Well, or as Bill pointed out, that if the trajectory of the revolving hydraulic fluid at very high volume as well as pressure in a hydraulic machine, if there was a slip knot in that hydraulic liquid, he had observed a whole machine that weighed almost tons lift off the ground for just a moment when it was switched on. Are other people having trouble with the sound, or are most people hearing me okay? Sometimes it's a local matter and sometimes not. So most people are getting the sound. I'm sorry, Marcin, that you're not getting the sound very well. We will have this on YouTube later. That same link, Fusion Reblend. So to finish the thought, this concept that if you pump high inertial fluid in the correct trajectory of the spiral on the torus, you get what's called translation of vorticity, which we're describing here. The physics of impulse power, the PDF, and again, thanks to Bill Donovan, at fractalfield.com/propulsion, you download the PDF hydraulic, the implosion group hydraulic propulsion.pdf. And you see that you can actually use Navier-Stokes equations, and Nassim should be jealous here, to calculate the ideal trajectory of that spiral on the torus to optimize the amount of lift you make. And the perfect one, of course, is related to the flame letter, the physics of the origin of Hebrew, which is a spiral on the torus. And indeed, if you close your eyes and you focus on a Hebrew letter very accurately so it fills your optical cortex, which is the sort of holographic brain as a liquid crystal, when you close your eyes and you fill the optical cortex with an image of the spiral on the donut in 3D, the Hebrew letter, the golem making, for example, of the Kabbalah, that what you're doing is you're not only choosing the angle of the donut torus magnetic domain, which is the smoke ring, which is the magnetic field of your holographic brain, just like you're throwing a thought form for horse whispering, you're blowing magnetic donuts with your mind. And by focusing on one Hebrew letter at once, you're choosing the angle of tilt of that donut. But more than that, as we explained, you're choosing the angle of plasma projection. So this takes on a deeper meaning, which we'll try to get into later, which is that when you die, you are effectively a plasma donut. That's what you are in Karatkov's electric measurements of the ghost after death. We know what the plasma domain looks like after death. We know what ghosts look like. We know what they do, and we know why. They go to the place of charge compression, where compression can become acceleration. And we know also in the movie Ghost that there are certain activities which allow a ghost to move something, which is called coherent emotion, which is the flame in the heart, as it were, this flame letter again. And we also know that ghosts cause a temperature reduction. You can find a ghost by looking to where it gets colder in the room, because the implosion field eliminates heat. It actually sucks in that heat. But even more importantly, that when you are a plasma domain, a cold plasma field, which is your ka, your coherent aura, your boat into the underworld, there is a way in which you can steer. And remember, when you're an astronaut and you're out there floating in space, you have to choose the direction in which to shoot your thruster. Well, the way you choose your direction to shoot your thruster when you're a ghost is the angle you visualize the spiral on the torus, called the Hebrew or Sanskrit letter. Most of you have seen my work on that at gogamine.info/DNA ring. So by choosing that angle, you're actually creating the propulsion vector directions in which to control your motion. And this becomes advanced science when we look later at the Ophanum Enochian, whose letters were used to make the movie Stargate, for very good reason, because these were about plasma projection. So we have explained the warp propulsion versus the impulse drive on Star Trek. Now we're going to talk about the raising of the Djedi. What is the Djedi physics? Remember that in ancient times, a Djedi tower was a device which had multiple functions. The geometry of the Djedi array of stones above the king's chamber in the pyramid actually creates a gravitational component which reduces the weight of the stones over the top of the king's chamber. So a Djedi was a plasma projector, also in the sense of a gravity maker. But a Djedi tower, in essence, is anything that can cause a plasma field to tower, to flame, to project. Hence, the raising of the Djed is similar to the myth of the sword and the stone, S-word from the S-tone, which is simply the ability to take the rotational inertia, which in physics is called mass, and translate the vorticity called an L. And that vorticity of charge in rotation translated in a perfect spiral will then emerge going in a line, so that plasma or charge going in a line is essentially energy, and plasma or charge going in a circle stores inertia, and in physics that's labeled mass. So to draw the sword from the stone is simply the skill to unpack the charge stuck going in a circle and cause that to then go in a line. And we also know that when in a phase conjugate array, imagine pine cones kissing noses again, that translation of vorticity changes the transverse wave to a longitudinal wave, and that is another deeper meaning for the sword from the stone, because the longitudinal or compressional component of electromagnetics, which only phase conjugation can produce, is what produces a wave, longitudinal or compressional, electromagnetic, which is by definition faster than light and can go through just about anything and can reconverge at a distance and cause action at a distance, which is superluminal, faster than light. It's the nature of superluminal waves and therefore the physics of things like the collective unconscious. And clearly we've spoken at length about how that's the physics of the flame in the mind and the physics of psychokinesis, the physics of how Ingo Swann heated a thermistor at a distance with his mind. So again, the ability to be a Jedi Knight, you see, is related to your ability to throw your plasma around. And this skill or ability to steer biologic charge, just like the Tai Chi master who's able to push you over at a distance with his Chi, he's taken the cold plasma field and steered it by creating the low pressure point in a tornado, the tornado being charge donut of his plasma aura, and by steering and directing the low pressure, the implosion or conjugate point, the tornadoes always follow the center of lowest pressure. Remember, in physics, since everything is string theory, wormhole, or vortex, that physics is only about tornadoes. There is no other subject functionally in physics. So if you can steer a tornado, one tornado, you can steer everything physics talks about. So this ability to steer plasma tornadoes is physics. And the ability to steer them depends on being able to steer the low pressure or implosion or conjugate point, the centripetal point. And that's exactly what the phase conjugate nature of mind allows. And as that builds charge inertia in your aura, you become a Djedi, the eye of the Djed, the eye of Horus, because phase conjugation is also the very nature of perception. We have many articles about that. So the other thing, just to say in passing, about the Star Wars story, the prequel, when Anakin Skywalker is found to have microchloridians in his blood, it's similar to the time travel stories at Montauk, where they called it Boson 7, where they make a measurement of the harmonics, the overtones, the braid density, the emission of the DNA, and when that particular frequency series, they called it boson 7, which had the same meaning as microchloridians in the blood in this Star Wars series, it was effectively that your DNA is imploding, and therefore you can bend space, you can steer charge, you are by definition psychokinetic. So it's a bit of a political hot potato, but it's quite clear that spectrum analysis of long waves in DNA would be an indicator of ability to be psychokinetic, because that long chain embedding phase coherence in DNA responds to the recursive braid triggered by human bliss experience. So you can find out who's going to be a Jedi in advance by checking for phase coherence in the blood. What they don't tell you in Star Wars, and they should, is because is that the skill to have the Jedi mind-bending ability in your blood requires this electrical skills, the hygiene skills, to learn to have a bliss experience. And that's why I say this is part of the necessary science lesson. And speaking of Jedi, so then this becomes the logo, this the plasma projection tubes, which we believe in the ancient times, here in the Egyptian carvings, was that not just their physics of rejuvenation, and hence our therifying device, but plasma projection became what they called the Shem unto the Lord. So the plasma tubes here in the therify device do exactly what a Jedi would do. They thought they were ancient light bulbs, but they're much more. They're designed to make time reversal rejuvenation in plasma, which is what Jedis can do. And let's see, there were some animations here. Yeah, this is the frequency signature of brainwaves in human bliss, which is the phase conjugate cause of perception. We did a course on that, which is how to become a Jedi. And this is another example of a phase conjugate model of perception from Steve Lehar, which is all part of our course on phase conjugate perception, fractalfield.com/conjugate perception. So right there is the core of this science lesson on how this imploding charge in your own brain, in your own aura, makes you a Jedi. And this allows then, as Bill Tiller proved, that focused human attention causes charge fields to compress, exactly what Luke Skywalker was being taught to do. And the geometry of focus, we now know, requires centripetal force, and centripetal force is always generated by phase conjugation, hence the frequency signature and the physics of implosion, the core of everything we talk about in these courses. Okay, so that ends our section on Jedi physics, and now, may the force be with you, Luke, we start on our extraterrestrial origins section. So this, this is a conversation about gaining the context from an extraterrestrial understanding of the extraterrestrial origins of history, religion, and biology on this planet, a synthesis that I've worked on for many years. And one of the things I would point out just at the outset is, if you look at the term Uru, as in E.B. Uru or Uru Asa Elem Jerusalem, there's so many words in our history which have the word Ur, Uru, at the center. Even this co-urs or the bow-urs, you know, a bow is Enki's lion, and ur had some meaning. So if you look at all these words like Durga and Asa Uru and Urak and Uru and Uran, so somebody, I would think some historian, would have to ask the simple question, who or what is Uru? I mean, it's so obvious that Uru is important to history. Look at that list of words. It's at the centerpiece of most of the sacred words of history, Uru. So somebody must ask who or what was Uru. And that is the question I am asking right now. And my hypothesis is that the Uru means of the ancient Draco or dragon blood, actually. Of the ancient dragon blood, for example, Ursprung means the ancient one in German. So the Uru, in my view, as in Urian, the Aryan race, and the Urigen, the origin, and the word for gold, D-O-R, D-Ur, all had that same root, U-R-U. And Anton Parks has some very specific things to say about the ages of Uras, and that's what we're going to talk about. And so we have the Ogurs and the Anagurs and the origin of the word Hungary, Anag Uria. Ag was male dragon, and Mag was female dragon, Mag Ur. And another fun example is mentioned here in this slide, that many scholars, including Sitchin, agree that the ancient Sumerian term for computer disk, really, now we have ancient Sumerian term for computer disk, is M-E. So, Me Asa Uru meant measurement, actually means Asa, the queen of the Uru, dragon blood, consults the computer disk. So if a queen of dragon blood consults a computer disk, it's Me Asa Uru, she measures. But there's so many words that are rooted, and very deeply rooted in this discussion. Now, we've talked also about the term Shem many times. I will raise a Shem unto the Lord. We talked about how Sitchin called that a high word firestone, and it became the word altar in church, the Shem. And we now know it means a fractal capacitor, literally a bioactive field implosion generator, a rejuvenation field generator. So it's such a mystery when our ancient ancestors always said, well, the first thing we have to do is build a Shem unto the Lord or we're toast. What they meant was we're aging catastrophically and we need to build our time reversal electric field. Otherwise, we're gonna be toast over here. And so calling this an altar in the church, the Shem, which is how it was transliterated, is a bit childish because the church and the altar only have meaning if they're making a bioactive field. That's why I actually think it's a bit funny when people go to all these trouble to study the numerology of these cathedrals and they don't even realize the only definition of success is if you made a bioactive field. So the numerology has meaning only if you generate the electric field, which is implosive enough to be bioactive and rejuvenation. Otherwise, forget all that sacred geometry stuff. It's pure numerology for the woo-woos. No, only the electrical engineering gives meaning to any of that. So study the electric field and you learn what the geometry means. I just think it's also funny here. In this slide, the word church, C-H-M, means access to a black hole for the Ur, for the dragons, for the Draco blood. So a black hole access to the black hole for the dragon blood is called a church. Church. And this then relates to what we are saying about so many of the ancient traditions, like the Maori. The Maori, like most every indigenous tribe on the planet Earth, if you ask them where the ancestors came from, they point to the sky and they say Pleiades in exactly the same way Anton Parks does. And the Maori talk about the Pleiades as they are the children of Maui. And then we have the Arion, the Orion, the Orion, Ora, gold origin, and all these words that If we see the roots of the words, even like plains of Sharon, meaning heaven, it's literally a place where charge can take flight because it's a fractal field, it's a conjugate, and therefore it's the illusion fields, it's Champs-Élysées. Yes, and so we were just saying what the male dragon Ag, the female Mag, and Ur. An means sun god, Anu, and Shem, we talked about the altar having meaning. So, Eden, you know, there's been a lot of argument over the meaning of the term Garden of Eden. And since I come from the town of Eden, New York, actually I was born just east of Eden, across from the grapes of wrath. And that was the winter of our discontent, if anybody remembers Steinbeck. But we did live there with the grapes of wrath there in east of Eden in western New York. That's where I was born. So I probably have an opinion on this. And my brother Michael was, you know, the Enlil archetype, and I get to be the Enki archetype. I don't think it's surprising that after 20 or 30 years of, yeah, that's right, Near East War, that's right, Thomas. I don't think it's surprising that after 20 years of intense Kundalini, I began to have this intense plasma flashback memories of Enki. And I wrote a book on the life of Enki. It's goldenmean.info/Enki. It's okay. I don't think I did quite as good a job as Anton Parks did in his book on Enki, but I think I did a better job than Sitchin did in his book on Enki and his memories. But the point I want to make was, that it is, you know, people say, well, are you a reincarnation of, and I'm not sure that means very much, but what I do think is that there was a central turning point in Earth history where the direction of the gene pool was steered dramatically by the presence of that tribe, that Uru ancestor, the Anunnaki Draco, And therefore, that plasma turning point in biologic history becomes central to anyone who's following the time reversal path of phase conjugation called Kundalini bliss. And so when you have intense plasma fire, naturally you flash back to the throat, to the slipknot, to the nexus of biological memory's turning point, which was the Ra, Abra, Abraham, Ra, Inki, also his lineage, Thoth, Thothmosis, the sons of Thoth, Enki's science officer. So that turning point in the plasma history of the gene pool becomes a nexus, a slipknot. So anyone who's trying to penetrate to the heart of the genetic memory, which is what intense Kundalini is obviously going to fixate on this family turning point, this plasma moment when the genetic biology was so dramatically steered by the interference, and I do mean the cloning, perhaps, of Enki, who was called Nudibud, meaning the cloner. So, naturally, if you have intense plasma experiences, you're going to come to this slipknot turning point in biological history. So, of course, I had a swoon experience in the gold sarcophagus of Tutankhamun in Cairo, and I began to have plasma flashbacks. I remembered how they used his blood to control the rain, because the pharaoh is going to get fired if he can't make rain. It's standard for pharaohs. You can't keep your job unless you're a rainmaker. So, you know, I had these memories, and it had to do with the plasma density of intense bliss experience. So this happened to Anton Parks. It just happens that I think Anton Parks did a better job correlating the history story with the plasma memories, with the flashbacks. Interesting, let's see if our Anton Parks slides are here. He's called the Tuatha De Dan, the peoples of the gods, Anu and Ana, An meaning sun god or ability to star inhabit. Yeah, and these, so this is where we mention the Anton Parks study of the ET histories. AntonParks.com is his main website, and I did a new update at fractalfield.com/Zeitlin, and my other articles are at goldenmean.info/the rest of the story. I have dozens of articles about this. And this is some of the articles at goldenmean.info/the rest of the story, and many of the articles that I put together over the years on the ET origins story. I wanted to move ahead now to the Anton Parks conversation, since we'll come back to these slides. But so in Anton Parks, he looked at Sitchin and decided that he felt that Sitchin had done a bad job of the historical research. And I believe that Anton Parks did better, actually. And then Anton Parks also compared O'Brien's work, The Shining Ones, which is our friend Edmund Marich, he did a transliteration of some of the Sumerian and the Sumerian tablets, and a more accurate transliteration. And then Anton Parks actually does comparisons between these three sources. And I think if a fair historian were actually to research, they would find that Anton Parks did a pretty good job in the historical analysis. And of course, there are many books out in French, the Adam Genesis, and the Testimony of the Virgin is where he says that Enki's wife tries to bring his body back, the body of Osiris, into the plasma field of the planet Venus, which is increasing in brightness, and we know it's a pent recursive orbit, which means it's literally can incarnate in the plasma domain of Venus, and an advanced stellar being as plasma could incarnate in that orbit. And so pull yourself together, Osiris, penis last. And Enki says that that Arnold Schwarzenegger was right. Anton Parks says Arnold Schwarzenegger was right, because when Enki left, he said, "I'll be back." This is the march to God. And then the point is that perhaps the best of the Anton Parks French books, Eden and Secret of the Dark Stars, are now available from Pahana Books in English. Secret of the Dark Stars. Here's we have Secret of the Dark Stars in English. And then his book Eden, which is the truth about the Garden of Eden. You know, Eden being a place of rejuvenation, actually. An electric field that would inhibit aging, and you could be permitted into Eden if you if you had the right bloodline, which means if your DNA was capable of the charge excitation to enable time reversal. That's how I transliterate the electrical engineering of someone saying, well, they wouldn't let me into the Garden of Eden. No, what they meant was that you didn't electrically qualify for the hygiene. So now here we have a spoiler alert. The spoiler alert is what did Anton Parks mean by the secret of the dark stars? And I believe, well, first of all, he is saying that essentially the very high, most psychokinetic or most powerful of the Uras, Uru, dragon or Draco or Anunnaki ancestors, which would correspond roughly to the winged dragon, sometimes called Siachar or Archon, as in archangel, or Mothmen, the high winged ancient dragon grandmothers, that they inhabited the dark stars. They inhabited the black holes. And in fact, they didn't just inhabit them, they steered them around. You know, you say, well, maybe it was fanciful physics when, this the Star Trek sequel Deep Space Nine, they went into the vortex, the wormhole. Remember, living next to the wormhole is highly economic because transportation access is access to money. So in real estate, it's location, location, location. So if you locate next to the wormhole called Deep Space Nine, and we're going to talk about Enneagram and nine plasma donuts and Sri Yantra and all that, making self-organization implosion. So they go into the Deep Space Nine in the next to the wormhole. And at one point, they find out that you can project your plasma through the wormhole, this intergalactic travel device. And by the way, the wormhole is inhabited with somebody who decides whether or not to spit out the bad guys. In other words, the wormhole is itself capable of intent. Very important to understand from the whole Deep Space Nine. And remember, when Andrew Puharik, who was the original inspirer of the story, The Nine, and Andrew had some serious astral hygiene problems, which I think actually was the death of him, but that's another story. But when he wrote The Nine, he said it was from a guy named Tom, who later he realized was Atum, Tom Atum, which is actually Enki. So Deep Space Nine is being written about an extended psychokinetic plasma family called the Nine, which was your number in the Nine was your role in the family when you were Anunnaki. This is well known in Sumerian. And also, this then became the Egyptian Ennead and the Greek Ennead and the nine levels of the roofs of the pagoda and the nine steps in Dante's Inferno. Now we did all the graphics for that about the plasma physics of how they discovered this, for example, at Los Alamos Plasma Research Laboratories, the physics of plasma donating of the nine with John McGovern and Tony Perrette at goldenmean.info/whaledreamers. And then we also put this physics of the nine at goldenmean.info/hellsmouth. So again, the numerology takes on meanings if it predicts what a wave is going to do, in this case, plasma physics. And it's true, if you get nine donuts above one another, they self-organize into a living body. And we're specifically saying that your chakras, you know, seven major plasma domains, have above them two additional, which you can feel when you have kundalini. You actually there's like an organ of perception up there, like an eyeball, and that gives yourself nine donuts nested one above the other, creating a self-organizing living body. And this was actually discovered in plasma domain physics at Los Alamos. And then John McGovern, who was busy believing he could read any carving in ancient petroglyphs on the caves of Australia, because it was a universal language of plasma, that the shamans were only using the language of plasma to do their they were only using the language of plasma to do their petroglyph carvings, because when you're a shaman and you close your eyes and you see the great interstellar beings doing plasma projection, the language of the symmetry of plasma is ancient alphabets. And for this reason, my friend John McGovern in Australia believed he could read any major petroglyph carving in ancient shamanic language. And then the only place he now publishes is with Tony Perrat at Los Alamos Plasma Physics, because they realized that the plasma physics they were studying there was basically the ancient language of the shaman, literally the plasma projectors. Now, in Anton Parks, he's describing here the two major language trees. And I think this is important because we know that the ancient Uras-Uru had a different language for the men of the tribe versus the women. So imagine sort of Worf in Star Trek. And so the men and the women had a separate language. And the separate languages were called Emesa and Emenir, I believe. Yes, Emegir and Emesa. And Emesa became the ancient Babylonian and the Akkadian language, which Joseph Smith was studying when he learned how to interpret the Urim and Thummim and the Mormon genetic records, which is famous for Draco, burnt on copper scrolls, which is how you recorded your genetic records if you were Draco. And the other language, the female language, was called Emenir, from our word to emanate. And this became Sumerian and Egyptian. So the point is that obviously a separate language for men versus women was at the root of the war among the sexes. And this is almost exactly true in a detailed history of Aboriginal Australia. The men and the women had separate language and separate words, and there was a curse structure between the men and the women. And many of the Aboriginal marriage laws, etc., come straight out of Alpha Draconis, from how the ancient dragon blood used to regulate their bloodlines. And obviously you needed a permit to replicate, which is to say there would be sex guilt. And this is a great part of the root of the sex guilt in the root of much religion. And also the caste system in India is straight out of the Draco law. And so there are many things we can learn by studying this Draco history, including the fear of women. And I often tell this story that I began studying extraterrestrial history because in undergraduate and graduate school, I became convinced that the psychoanalysis of history of Earth, and certainly the psychoanalysis of the history of religion on this Earth, was almost dramatically associated with fear of women. So in a sense, the origin of religion on this planet, the central theme is fear of women, fear of the psychokinesis of women, whether it's the Inquisition or the Muslims or the Mormons. You know, fear of women is the central theme. So I was quite determined historically from my studies of the psychoanalysis history that I was going to get to the root of the question, where did this fear of women come from? And after many years of working on this question, I definitely concluded that the origin of the fear of women on planet Earth is ET. The origin of the fear of women on this planet did not come from this planet. And that is a fundamental necessity to understand. So maybe we should tell a little bit of that story. While we're talking about Enki's line here, let's zoom in here on the bloodline here. So this is Enki's view of this line. He's talking about the roots of Sanskrit here. Maybe you can't see this very well, but just a little bit of the story from Secret of the Dark Stars. So basically, it's true the Uras Draco bloodline root is Alpha Draconis, I believe. The shadow of Alpha Draconis, we know, is the Arabic letter L, as in Elohim, and Alpha Draconis is the star map at Angkor Wat, and also Alpha Draconis, I believe, is the star map. No, the Orion is the star map of the Hopi tribe, of the Hopi villages. Heaven's Mirror is the book about the Draco star map at Angkor Wat. And so the ability of to use a star map on the planet, like the many star maps of Orion, which are so famous, allows you to use the local magnetics as a fractal lens to project your plasma into the star body, which the local star map is a fractal of. So you can use the Orion star map, so famous on the Giza Plateau in Egypt, as a way to lens your way magnetically to inhabit those stars. So although their root was Alpha Draconis, and we believe there was a particular star system there which had a methane pool atmosphere, and as a result, the Draco Uru Anunnaki were largely nitrogen breathing, and they had a lipid oil-based blood, much repercussion about the oil industry on this planet, and that oxygen was a bit of a poison to them, and actually that water was a bit of a poison to them. And we believe that that was part of the origin of the kosher of the Jews, which was that Enlil, otherwise known as Yahweh, being Draco, required low oxygen, high nitrogen, and his meat needed to have the water removed, hence kosher, and many other aspects of kosher, because they were very susceptible to our diseases here, and they were aging catastrophically. And more particularly, that there were two types of electron transport in their blood, a red phosphorus and a white phosphorus, which were the red Draco and the white Draco, and that then the white Draco was thought to be unclonable, but actually the origin of the Caucasian is very psychokinetic, the white Draco, very famous, kind of white Mothman story, many stories about this. But there's a particular point in Anton Parks where he's saying that Enki, otherwise known as Nudimud Samuel, the cloner, that he was shocked one day, he woke up, that his mother snuck in some of the very psychokinetic white Draco DNA into his cloning recipe, unbeknownst to him, and he thought they were unclonable, but in fact it was a turning point where he got maximum psychokinetic into the Takadama, Adam and Eve, Adam, meaning the red race, and more specifically, Enki called us the Adamic race, which means red, Adam, the red race, because of his fascination with the iron in our blood, which was not in their blood. The story here was that having gone underground for so many decades after the last planetary catastrophe, that the natural chlorophyll-based blood had changed to an iron-based blood after millennia underground. And part of the kind of the Lemurian myth. And so using iron for the oxygen and charge transport instead of phosphorus meant we were the red race. And that made us strong. Takadama, Scandinavia, Asakaan, Scandinavia. So the red race for us was because of the uniqueness of the iron in our blood. And we note the difference between chlorophyll and hemoglobin is simply the replacement of one or two molecules, which is to say that the translation from a hemoglobin, from a chlorophyll blood to an iron-based blood, put us in a unique position for Encke to do his genetic experiments. And the other thing, the history here is important, feeling into Anton Park's description of Enki Ra psyche here, he was treating his genetic cloning as a kind of art form, creating a sculpture for the future. Whereas his family, who was basically writing the check for him to do it, knew his father and Lil, his brother, were straight Draco, and so the genetic experiments of Enki were producing humans was simply to make slaves and snack food, and so, you know, Enki found this very painful. But this really goes deep into the psyche of the genetics of our research. And the other point to be made was that apparently, again reading Anton Parks, that the whatever Cro-Magnon or ancient monkey that Enki chose to cross in his cloning cookery, and Michael Tellinger has located some of these cloning cookery ovens in South Africa, actually, where Enki had the Draco virgins cranking out the Takadama from the cloned eggs. But the other thing was that when Enki chose which essential monkeys or Cro-Magnon to cross, it was clear that he chose particularly a particular species, we could call them ancient monkeys or apes, that he saw them to have exhibited compassion to other animals. And Enki had never seen compassion before in his life. And so the very presence of the possibility of compassion was central to Enki's choice of how to start his cloning experiments. Now, if you think about what compassion is literally the ability to insert or embed your plasma superposed on that of another being so you can feel inside them. Remember, we did the whole inside out metaphor in our heart coherence discussion where the plasma donor of the heart embeds and you turn yourself inside out recursively and then you embed your aura into another as if it is you. So turn yourself inside out and embed your plasma in someone else and you begin to feel their feelings. So perfect compression identifies you, the dent caused by phi, identify, and you identify with the emotions of the other, and you have this ability to experience the information radiating from their blood, their imploding DNA, as if it were your own. And this is a functional deep physics of the nature of DNA as a collectivizing survival field effect generator, the collective unconscious. Why did everyone electrically feel when 3,000 people were killed on 9/11? They measured it at the Princeton nuosphere, which we now know as capacitive coupling. Well, the physics is because the collective genetic morphic field, the real physics of morphic resonance, is the physics of a phase conjugate electric field, implosive or fractal field, which has this everywhere at once quality described very well in phase conjugate materials in the paper Alice in Barium Titanate Land, the physics of the collective unconscious. So Enki is like saying, basically at that point, Enki is building a vaccine for the Orion Wars, which is us. The Orion Wars were called the Oxygen Wars. Now you know why, as it's Total Recall here, it's a Mars story. The atmosphere. No, it's because if the nitrogen's going up on a planet and a radioactivity is going up, well, then you know the Dracos are winning. Whereas if the oxygen's going up and the radioactivity is going down, then you know the oxygen breathers, the human bloods are winning. And we should have mentioned that here. Here is the so-called Iradia couple from Russia. And it was documented there that they having been born and grew up too close to Chernobyl, that actually radioactivity was a charge accelerant for them. A bliss device, in the sense of the brown nuclear battery. A few gamma rays actually can trigger electron transport if you mutate in that direction. And the Draco's home star was more radioactive. So they need a little bit of radioactivity. They like it. So if the radioactivity is going up on the planet, you could even do a little conspiracy theory about Fukushima and the Dracos if you wanted. Point being that humans are proven, right here with the Iranian couple in Russia, proven to be capable of reverting to the kind of Draco blood which actually profits from a radioactive environment. It's actually a metabolic accelerator for the Draco, because that was the nature of the electric field on their home star. Whereas we know in Sumerian, when they came here, they reported aging catastrophically. They were used to the immortality devices, the little suspensors that held up Harkonnen, visualize Ariel Sharon on life support. You get the flavor. So what did we mean by a vaccine for the Orion Wars? Let's talk about that a bit. So here is, this is probably poetry, but I think there's probably some physics here, but we notice that the Orion arm of our galaxy right here, which, I'll zoom in a little bit more. Like the golden mean spirals, which are the gravity makers that hold our galaxy together, have one major little breakup only, and that major little breakup is the Orion arm, basically us. And I just remember so vividly we were doing rituals on the star map in Pennsylvania in God's country, Coudersport, the Eagle star map in Pennsylvania. We were doing rituals with the Reverend Mothers there. That's another long story. And they said, "Oh, look up in the stars. And when you see all the stars blowing up around Orion, that was us. We did it." And what they meant was, you know, in the sense of Blade Runner or Tron, "I have seen the starships burning off the shoulders of Orion." What did he mean? Well, what he meant was that little galactic discontinuity in the Orion arm is the Orion Wars. We blew up a whole bunch of stars. And why did we do that? Well, this is the Orion Wars, which are called the Oxygen Wars, because essentially it's like Elon Musk and Mark Zuckerberg getting together and decided, "Oh, we need to stick millions of dollars into preventing robots from taking over our civilization. Right now, it's urgent." Well, why is that an urge deep into their psyches? Because it has been a problem. The Borg did take over. It has happened. And we are it, you know. And essentially, the difference in the Orion Wars between the Jedi, those who would like charge in DNA, and those who would like a mechanical kind of progress, that difference is the subject of the Orion Wars. And that difference is manifest as what excites charge in your blood, what gives you access to psychokinesis. In the case of the Draco, with their, and we have to credit Bill Donovan, now Elizabeth, for his original paper on the chemistry of alien blood, and all of this again is at fractalfield.com/fusion-in-the-blood. But he developed this elaborate study of the chemistry, which he was a very advanced chemist, needs to be respected, that work, that with a lipid-based blood with a phosphorus charge transport and nitrogen breathing, cyanogen exhaling, you know, the poisonous dragon's breath, and requiring a radioactive environment for charge transport, that your form of bliss would be very different. There wouldn't be the kind of bliss we know is not actually possible, but you would have a metabolic acceleration from radioactivity. However, if you look at the physics of psychokinesis, which is really the Jedi story here, the difference becomes even more dramatic between humanoid blood chemistry, iron-based, water-based blood, and Draco Uru blood chemistry, which is oil-based. The old joke, if you think that a Draco plasma shapeshifter has taken out your senator or worse, Rupert Murdoch, his girlfriend reported how the plasma shapeshifter took him out. They need to control the media. Well, if you think that the plasma shapeshifters have taken over your government, well, there's a very simple solution. the way Rupert Murdoch's girlfriend got him to drop the shapeshift was slipping LSD in his tea, and Raylan Rusbacher told me the same story about Norman Rusbacher. But remember, the people who these plasma parasites would parasitize and essentially take over become more susceptible if you're depressed, if you're drunk, if you're alcoholic, if you're addicted, anything that puts holes in your aura. And so if you have implosion, a form of bliss in your aura, you have no problem with this form of parasitism. But the point we were trying to make was about the difference in the electrical quality of the possibility of psychokinesis and human bliss, which is not available to the Draco line. The Draco were highly telepathic and hard to kill. They had two hearts, as Phil Schneider actively reported the Uru line from his experience under Dulles. The reason they were highly telepathic is electrically interesting. Credo Mutwa was telling us about how the Zulu shaman knew, of course, Enki was a name for Kilimanjaro, and they knew that the eating some of the flesh of the greys was similar to eating monoatomics, and he knew why. But that the Draco had, from the dissections of these greys at Roswell, we know they had a nervous system which was mostly silica. And this meant higher phase propagation velocities in the wiring of their nerves, which meant a much higher frequency signature in their brainwave. Higher frequency signature brainwave, think of Tibetan gamma, 44 hertz, etc., means much more telepathy. But, and this is the point, that the low frequencies, which is possible in the human nervous system, which slow away propagation velocities, and the resonance of this cavity, means that the human brainwave for bliss, which we now know is alpha, beta, golden ratio, which is precisely the 8 hertz, 13 hertz, that whole cascade, from the cover of my book, and by the way, the new version of my book, 23 pages added with the new physics, we got the now frequency, the equation for the frequencies of the Meyer wave, the HRV, LF, and VF, VLF, all being a phase conjugate collapse wave, the new frequency harmonic proof of the frequency signature of ADP, ATP, adenosine diphosphate, triphosphate, mitogenic radiation. We proved all of that. It now is my equation for phase conjugate negentropic collapse, in addition to hydrogen geometry and photosynthesis and Earth year and Venus year, all in the new book, fractalfield.com, the printed version, the PDF online, and the Amazon version all have the additional 23 pages, the updated physics. Ain't it cool? So back to the point. If you look at the frequency signature from the equation, which is this caduceus here, the frequency signature from the equation, 2.78, 4.5, 7.29, 11.8 hertz, which is the caduceus, which we now know is the frequency signature, not just of the major harmonics of the Schumann resonance, low frequency, phase conjugate negentropic collapse, why Earth Gaia is self-organizing negentropic, and what makes us able to emerge from chaos in general. So, back to our story. Humans can make that exact low frequency cascade in their brainwaves, and that gives them ability to embed in larger, longer waveforms. Things like planetary bodies. Low frequency long wave embedding is possible for humans, is not possible from Draco, from the simple physics that you cannot get that long a wave embedded in their higher frequency brain waves. More telepathy, but less compassion. That is Draco. That's why she said, "I am 7 of 9. I shall never feel alone. It is a privilege to be assimilated." The point was that You will always feel telepathy, but you will never feel compassion. And that is the difference in blood chemistry, which ultimately is at the root of the raising of the Djedi and the possibility of psychokinesis. So all of the things that enable humans to achieve a bliss science, and remember that's the subject of all, most of our other courses, is the science of how to get humans into bliss experience, charge implosion, charge radiance, negentropy, rejuvenation, self-organization, immune health, immortality, definition of sustainability, all that stuff. It is possible for those who choose the route of charging living DNA to embed the long wave, and is not possible for the Draco Borg line, who have chosen thousands of generations of cloning. Remember what we said about DNA that was set free. We said that, you know, the DNA in the corn you buy in the store today has been monocultured for generations. The tragedy, the obscene sin that is Monsanto, and that DNA is pissed. It's angry and it's poison. And so you eat that white flour and that corn DNA and you get lots of mucus because your immune system cells, not self, pain. That DNA is like a kid whose father's been in jail for 100 generations, and that is one angry kid. Whereas the DNA from the ancient Hopi blue corn, which I saw call the wind and could be used to actually bend a magnetic line, and that DNA was so smart, it was the family pet. It would only germinate if you sang the right song. That's happy DNA. And that came from extreme genetic diversity and DNA that had been set free for hundreds of generations. And that is the essential difference that I call the Monsanto mistake, the need for genetic diversity, because it's the same thing as a fractal field and the same thing as harmonic inclusiveness. So, the Draco view came to be after having only cloning was legal for hundreds of generations. Remember, Anki's family, Anu and Lil, and the family were running from a female-dominated, highly telepathic culture, origin of fear of women, in the Pleiades, described in detail when Anki comes from the cloning ovens with his father and settles here on Earth. And the brother, the half-brother, Enlil, Yahweh, who was called Satam, the origin of our term Satan, meaning territorial administrator. And Enlil was basically a cloning mistake, which got away. And that's the origin of Enlil. And we think probably that Anne Rice was right. He became the largest plasma parasite in the solar system. Anne Rice says E-N-K-I-L, who I believe is probably what you call the Grim Reaper, and pretty well accurately described in the movie Ghost and Flatliners, comes to get you at death if your plasma is not implosive enough to go through a star. So how did his DNA become the largest plasma parasite in the solar system? Because after those number of generations of cloning, the opposite of freedom hits DNA almost as seriously as the agony of how Dolly the sheep died. I'm not saying that genetic engineering is evil. I'm not even saying that cloning is evil. But I'm saying if you do not know what electrically it is to have a soul, you damn well shouldn't be playing with messing with DNA. And Anki understood a little bit, but the good news was his mother really understood. And she snuck in the bullet in the furnace, the highly psychokinetic. And she was taught by a group called the Life Designers, who were called the Kadistu, from which we get our word caduceus, who had the long-term collective survival of DNA in mind. And that's why there is some very high order intent possible behind our gene pool, in part. But right now, our star is about to burp, as it does regularly. And the real estate here is losing value rapidly because the sun burps predictably. And The sun has went to a great deal of trouble to cooking up such a great gene pool here, but the sun is saying, look, the physics of the rapture applies, which is that you do not want to be the left behind, the religious fundamentalists. No, during the rapture, the guns will melt. What did they mean? They meant that anything that's not a phase conjugate dielectric will generate heat for the same reason that the Brown's gas, monoatomic hydrogen, will burn steel but won't burn your skin, because you can distribute the charge, the steel cannot. So that's why the guns will melt during the rapture. And so the rapture basically is an implosive conjugate fractal field, meaning that you will generate heat unless you are a perfectly implosive shareable wave, the same way that the hero in the movie Powder survived the lightning, the same way Danion Brinkley survived the lightning, otherwise known as Kundalini. So there is a story to the Mori here, which is that in order to be the vaccine for the Orion Wars, and we'll get to the 22 families. In fact, maybe we should do that here. The 22 families that, here we are. So this is from Montauk Survivor, Stuart Swerdlow's version of the various extraterrestrial groups that did interference in the Earth's gene pool. And this actually overlaps pretty well, I think, with Anton Parks. And we discussed this work with Stuart Swerdlow at goldenmean.info/invasion. So notice that he's saying the various sort of chess pieces on planet Earth are effectively manipulated by different extraterrestrial groups. Notice that the origin of the Hebrews in Egypt is from Sirius A. And this fits the Syrian roots of Enki's mother, and it fits the book God King Akhenaten by Daniel Stewart, where the Syrians are, remember we said, teaching Akhenaten to build the Menti sun temple, which is basically a plasma projector, so soul groups can do their bliss and get back into stars. And Akhenaten screws up the checkbook and has to run for his life and change his name to Moses and becomes a gold powder cook and founds the Essenes. It's all downhill from there until his son, basically Tutankhamun, becomes the biggest part of the Jesus story. And even Lawrence Gardner accepts the Egyptian origins of the Jesus myth now, and Lawrence was no slouch as a historian. But anyway, so you have these serious maps of which cultures on our planet were associated with various ET groups. And the extraterrestrial groups are in general, and again, the Star Wars, Star Trek motif, they're categorized by whether they're interventionist or non-interventionist, meaning did they respect the prime directive, which is say, thou shalt not interfere. You know, if you find Aboriginal peoples in the wilderness, don't mess with them because you have something to learn and they have something to learn from themselves, so you shouldn't interfere. And respecting individual freedom is sacred in that sense, because that's how among stars DNA grows up. So you can tell which ETs, aside from knowing which ETs to talk to, by if they came from plasma through the heart of a star, you should talk to them. If they came in heavy metal, you probably should not, because they're from the wrong side of the tracks. Well, another way you can tell is if they respect the prime directive, because you know that if they respect individual freedoms, that means that they have the collective intent of the genetic material in part in their belief system. And those who did respect the prime directive were the Arcturians, to some extent the Syrians, although the Syrians were famous for selling guns to both sides of the war. And the Arcturians and Procyon. These groups were very respectful of the prime directive. Whereas very much more on the interventionist side, you have the Rigelians, which are described at Montauk in detail by Stuart Swerdlow, a very interventionist on the Draco side. Rigel was part of Orion, as you know, and the Rigelians and the Draconians did the genetic intervention, which became interference, which became Zeta Reticuli, and therefore the Greys. And so this is an interventionist lineage, and this becomes part of the New World Order story. And I do think Laura Eisenhower is probably right that President Eisenhower didn't have bad intent when he gave up when the Greys threatened him. It wasn't just ego. He believed that he had no choice. But clearly, by allowing the Greys to do abductions, the shapeshifters got in and they began to take over the military. And the story is that the last of the military that actually could have any resistance was the Navy. And when Secretary of the Navy committed suicide there, that famous Admiral Borda, it was kind of the end of the line for those who were trying to resist the shapeshifters who had taken over a good chunk of the U.S. military. This is the story. And there are stories of seeing vertical slit eyeballs, etc. And so this gives a bit of truth to the story that some of the shadow government of the United States is part of this negative conspiracy. And I always say conspiracy theory is proven only when you have the solid data. But and we should focus on the problem. And I still choose to see the problem as being one of education. But from this view, you see how Borda and Secretary of the Navy there, Norman Rusbacher, was kind of control was taken, part of the Phil Schneider story, that the United States came too much under the influence of. And I do think that George Bush and Dick Cheney were part of the unfortunate in this case. But and the other thing from the Draco history here is that the Draco at one point, Uras, murdered millions of humanoids who in the diaspora from Earth had inhabited the Lyran civilization, the Prism of Lyra book. And the Lyran women were admired, the ones who were red-haired, because they were more psychokinetic. Why? Mineral, iron in the blood. And so this picture of the galactic history is just one of many. And what I'm pointing out to you is how much synergy there is between all these sources. This is other evidence for the story we're telling. The language tree from it's called Ur-Elic. The Uralic language becomes Finnic, Ugo-Hungarian, which became the Lord of the Rings story, and that's Sumerian. But you see that the Ur is at the root of the language tree here. And in fact, it is said that the Draco carvings on the Chinese walls were readable only by the Hungarian, Finno-Ugaric. And we're going to get to the Hungarian Draco. So it becomes a universal story here. But we'll play that. We'll have the slide up in a minute of the geometric roots of the Ugo-Hungaric. This slide here is an attempt to look at this sort of myth of the birth of the hero version of this story, that this one Sumerian Anunnaki family is so archetypal, myth of the birth of the hero again. You know, Anu's the father, Enki, Merk, Dagon, and Merku, Mercurial, Enki becomes Ra, Abram, and Lil Yahweh, Yehovah, Ilu, and then Thoth. So this is the family, members of the family. And this one family becomes essentially the same in the Egyptian tradition. So Enki is Ptah, and Enlil's Amun, Enki is also Atun. And Thoth Hermes is Tehuti, line of David. DWD became TWT, Tehuti became David, the line of David. So everywhere you read the line of Davis. And this became Thothmosis, which is Thoth, sons of Thoth. Visit said Thoth was a myth, but he's wrong. Thoth was a being who was literally Thoth Hermes. And so sons of Thoth is literally Thothmosis is the name of the Egyptian royal lineage. So, and then you have the same family in Greek. Anu is Apollo, Enki is Poseidon, Enlil is Zeus. In the Roman, Enlil is Jupiter. In Babylonian, Anu is An. In Babylonian, Enki is Ea or Zoroaster. And Enlil is Elil. Enki's name also, end of parenthesis, is Sam, Samuel, Padmasambhava. And then Africa, Kilimanjaro is Enki, so you have Atun Amun. In the Christian, Enki is Baal, Bo-ba-Baal, which is Enlil's name for Enki, as in Bohemian. And he is also called Lucifer, and Lucifer's eye, Lucifer's stone, becomes the Kaaba stone. Whereas Enlil Yahweh is Michael, Gay-Ogre. Gay-Ogre means world dragon. In Celtic, Og is male dragon, Gay means world, which is the origin of our term George, gives a whole new meaning to George Bush. And so the Michael line is actually the Enlil Yahweh line. Whereas Thoth is a line of David, and Moses and his son, remember in Lawrence Gardner's analysis of the Egyptian roots of Christian, that Moses and Aaron becomes Jesus and Aaron becomes, so that the biggest part of the Jesus myth is the story of Tutankhamun, actually, even according to Lawrence Gardner. So the book is called Out of Egypt by Ahmed Osman, which then Lawrence Gardner documents the scholarship to show the Egyptian roots of the Jesus scene story. And notice that William too even took that further and says that Enki is the origin of the Oedipus myth. It's pretty well documented in the Sumerian that Enki's father, Enki basically ends up, in a murderous relationship with his father, but Enki's father killed his father's father, Olalu. So the Oedipus myth comes right, and it was a battle over the mother. You see the myth of the birth of the hero. The Oedipus story comes right out of the Enki Sumerian story, and this is William Thu. And that whole history conversation we have at goldenmean.info/recipe for schizophrenia. So, but you see the central nature of this myth that this Sumerian family, and now not only are the basically the old Hungarian Rovash Irosh is Draco, which becomes Finno-Ugaric, which is the language of Lord of the Ring, which is the ring donut, but also the Frieslanders are actually reading Sumerian without translating the northern. Stuart Swordlow is further saying that the leading families of the planet, and I think this is more ancient history than current history, flow out of this reptilian culture civilization. For example, the Red Draco becomes the Red Shield, which is called the Rothschilds, and so that sort of fits into that very famous story. So I did this some years back. I did this chart here. And let's see if this is readable. I'll blow this up a little bit. So we start with the archetype two families. You have the Seraphim and the Ophanim. And the high Draco Uruk, their ancestors, the winged dragon, become the Seraphim. Serate means to cut by five. Whereas the other half of the crossing over, Ebi Uru means crossing over in Hebrew. Crossing over, what was crossed over was the Ebi Ibis bird brain. Remember, Thoth is modeled as a bird brain. So the Ebi side of the family was Ophanic, the whirling ones. And that became locally the Aku versus the Draku, which is to say Atun versus Amun. And this became on the Aku side, it became the Dogon, the bird tribe, return of the bird tribe. In Aboriginal, it was Valnapa. In Cherokee, this was called Adawi. And later in Golden Dawn, this was called the Archon, or the winged ones, or the whirling ones. Whereas, sort of in the language of Dune, this becomes this group called Theuba.com here. I don't know if you see this. But the Orion was then, most of the inhabitable planetoids in the Orion sector were conquered by the Draco from Alpha Draconis. And hence, you have all the star maps of Orion, and Telos, or starbase one, being Tak, Al-Natak, and Mintaka. Tak means Orion, as in Takadama, and also Mag-Zitak, Mag meaning dragon queen, Zitak meaning from Orion, from which we get our word Melchizedek. And so Takadama, Tak means Orion, as in Mintaka and Al-Natak, the belt stars of Orion. And that was called Telos, or Starbase 1, from the Draco conquest of Orion. And hence all of the star maps of Orion, particularly the Hopi and the Egyptian, become these projectors from which to inhabit basically what were the home star of the Urus. And this is correlated well, of course, with the star map of Ed Anker Wat and Heaven's Mirror of the Draco, but also from Theuba.com, the famous French book, who says the origin term Yahweh is Yehovah, Theuba.com, and they say that they went to find the ancestors of the dragons, the Theuba, they went to Thuban, which we now know is in Draco. And Arrakis is also in Alpha Draconis, and that's the home of Dune. And later we found out that the group that named Arrakis in Alpha Draconis had read Dune before they discovered the star there that they named Arrakis. And the Rigelians are talked about a great deal at Montauk from Orion. And so this is basically the story of the family. And then this, in local terms, becomes the Enlil and Enki bloodline, where Enlil becomes Yahweh, Jehovah, Michael, Amun, and Snake God, or Levite. And Enki's side of the family, Mother Ida, Enki is also known as Ea, for whom we have the word earth, Ea's earth, and the word Dea. Our D apostrophe Ea, our word God, means Enki, actually originally Ea, and that's for whom earth was named. And he was then called Adonai or Atun. And remember, Akun Atun versus Akun Tutankhamun. This was the Atun Amun cult in Egypt, which was basically the two brothers. And the Amun cult, remember, in Egypt was addicted to mushroom for their bliss, whereas the Atun was the Soma, the acacia, as Ananda so well documents from Norway in the brain chemistry. And then Lucifer became Bohem, as in Beelzebub's tales to his grandson, Beelzebub Ba'abel. Babylon was actually the land of Enki, Ba'abel. And he was also known as Fish God and Zoroaster and Kiliman, and then his son Marduk and Ra. And so then and it wasn't his other son, it was actually his science partner Hermes, became Ningishida, Thoth, Tehuti, Tule, and the line of David, and that's who became Quetzalcoatl. And you know that Quetzalcoatl was the Viracocha story. It was the same lineage, and as in God King Akhenaten, and then later when Maurice Cotterell wrote Tutankhamun Prophecies, he showed that the solar physics of Quetzalcoatl was proof that this was the Tutankhamun science. And literally, the Tutankhamun science, we now know, is the Thoth science. And therefore, the Quetzalcoatl story becomes identical with the Thoth story. The proof is the fact that their solar physics was the same. For example, they both recognized that when the solar flare patterns changed, such as to prevent women from ovulating, which was the computer animation on the surface of the lid of Palenque for Maurice Cotterell, that they needed to leave. And that's when they said, I'll be back. So they explained while they left, why they left on the lid of Palenque, because of solar physics. And that's a good hint for the rest of us. I wanted to show, well, let's just go back a little bit in our conversation. This is the slide about the similarity between the hemoglobin and the chlorophyll. You see, the iron is the difference at the center. In chlorophyll, the magnesium, and in hemoglobin, you have the iron. And Bill says that this magnesium center is actually susceptible to cold fusion in humans. And so if the chemistry is right, the reason humans actually can be warm-blooded has to do with cold fusion with magnesium. Because of our ancient relationship between the iron in our hemoglobin and magnesium. And the replacement of iron to magnesium is the only difference between chlorophyll and hemoglobin, which is the green blood of our ancestors, actually. So we had some more pictures. Yeah, well, this is just what we're saying, which was that the physics of humans' ability to achieve bliss, you had that low frequency harmonics under 20 hertz in the heart here in the power spectra of the EKG. This is done by the Heart Math Institute after I showed them how to do it. The low frequencies in the heart, onset coherence measured to create coherence in DNA braiding here. Glenn Ryan did this study at my suggestion. So here is a measurement of the DNA plait braid structure recursively imploding and braiding, getting phase coherence of long wave to short wave. And that is the bliss process possible in humans, particularly because we now know those low frequencies in the heart brain, particularly in the brain, would be a phase conjugate pump wave. So the DNA can implode right down to the level of hydrogen with the braiding in response to human bliss and phase conjugate brain waves. And so that enables us to have a whole different kind of fusion in the blood and bliss mechanic and psychokinesis, raising the Jedi Knight, which is not possible in a Borg, in a machine empire where only cloning is legal and DNA has not been set free. So let's see, this is showing, we did a morph here. This is the ancient Sumerian goddess figure in the Ubayad top left. And there's actually a morph of this, but this is the actual shape of the Draco ancestors as seen from Phil Schneider and also not Lisa Royale, but Kelanta. Yeah, the Kelanta science people. And here you have what Enlil looked like as a cross Ibi-Uru with the Draco. So this is the ancient Draco, and this is the Sumerian goddess. So you see that mom was a Draco. That's okay. It's not embarrassing. It's just nice to know where your ancestors came from. And this is Anton Parks. This is Enki here. Enki was a cone head, but he looked like a frog, basically. And this is his Girku, which otherwise known as Silmarion or Tuoi Stone or Vril or Fire Crystal. It was an implosive phase conjugate. It's not really a good picture that the actual crystals are eight-sided and they're phase conjugate. And that crystal can project a plasma beam, which is literally the physics of Luke Skywalker's sword. And that we now know the microwave interferometry, actually even the wavelengths to do that, to do plasma containment at a distance, to make the Foo Fighter or the Luke Skywalker sword. And this gives you an idea of the density of the bliss experience for Anton Parks here. This is some of his early books. So the language crystal or the green scone, the Ugor, the Girku, we say downloading Enki's iPhone. Actually, it's a matter of when you have such intense bliss experiences, you go to the root of collective genetic memory, and this is one of the roots. Yeah, so we did this part already. Yes, okay. So the happily ever after here is just that we can see now what we need to do for our blood chemistry to achieve the proper psychokinesis. In later years, if we read kind of where that story ended up, that Enki became discouraged and he's basically attacked by the remnants of his brother's empire and ends up essentially having to hide. And then, if we believe Anton Parks, bringing Osiris back in the orbit of Venus. But the point is that that it isn't always necessary to see the return of the dragon ancestors as a conspiracy plot. I see it more as a failure to educate. namely, that the current themes in planetary history, for example, the Monsanto controversy, are essentially about knowing what DNA is for. And if we're informed by ancient history, we can have a whole new sense of prioritizing in understanding what to choose government and politics to do. Remember, in last week's course, we said that a beehive cannot swarm unless its plasma field has achieved critical mass. And also the beehive cannot swarm unless there is someone of royal blood to steer. And the physics of royal blood was simply someone whose DNA, in this case a queen, was implosive enough to navigate or be the time lord. So what is it about navigation that requires this vision, this content of the superluminal? I mean, we explained that the word body polis is a name for that projective collective plasma that's generated by the ability to have collective bliss. And so the definition of politics in that sense, you never have any form of actual politics that is a collective navigable plasma bliss body unless there is collective bliss, which is why collective bliss is so threatening to politics, because the collective bliss is the decision-making process that forms the government, which is to say, steers the collective tornado. And I say that humans could approach that if they would move their democracy toward a very rapid voting system such that the feedback loop becomes direct. The collective awareness, you know, an hour later that you realize how 200 million people have voted and they've clicked instantly. So the consensus process grows and the feedback loop gets shorter and shorter, and that's called self-awareness. And so the collective mind could begin to form out of that collective implosion experience. And in the process, if soul groups formed and learned to do their bliss together, and learned to lucid dream together, as we talked about, then you have the pod or the cocoon. And, you know, that may sound radical, but it starts very simply with humans realizing that all of their decisions need to be based on charge. As we were talking about from Celestine Prophecy, all human interaction is about charge. What does that mean? We said choosing who to kiss and what to eat. It's all about attracting charge density. The tingle you feel when you bite into a whole apple, the tingle is the food. That's the charge. So the whole foods and the natural food movement, the natural environment movement, the quality of grace, the quality of chi, the quality of may the force be with you, is all pointing to the same science, a hygiene to allow humans to build a very large aura. And the lesson of history is a lesson of navigation, of inhabiting the space by imploding your charge. There was one slide we missed in here, and that was here from the ancient alphabet of the Hungarian, we said was Rovash Irash. Uru Asa, Rovash Irash, the ancient alphabet of the Magyars, the An-Ag-Ur, the Hungarians. And that alphabet here, we realized that the symmetry of the old Hungarian, Rovash Irash, was the same tetracube, which is Hebrew. And we remember how you inhabit the cube of space by recognizing the direction of the plasma donuts from every vector direction. We did this whole analysis in the detailed web article, goldenmean.info/dragonscriptdna, which was basically the Hungarian Finnish root of the Lord of the Ring that the Tolkien used. So the tetracubic root of Rovash Irash, which we now know is how you read Old Draco, was the psychokinesis of steering the space and navigating the space, which was by being able to sequence the plasma donuts in the right symmetry array, which in the case of Rovash Irash we see as a tetracube. Now, this is a good introduction to the more advanced Ophanic Enochian. Let's see if we have that here. So Yes, let's maybe finish the slides in a bit more order. So this is the Orion arm that was broken, and this is the double vortex that is Orion. Remember, originally when you said yod hey vah hey, you say yod and you make a cone yod, yod hey, a morsel of space filling, five, and then vah. The cone goes the other way, yod and vah. And if you invoke the two cones, the plasma donut pair, vortex pair that you build in front of you looks like Orion. Actually, this is the shape of Orion in 3D. It's a double plasma cone. And this was actually what it meant to be a Yahweh, which, and Lil later was a wannabe, but the actual physics was how to inhabit. Literally implode your plasma and inhabit a stellar array. This is what the advanced beings did. And this then introduces the plasma symmetry of the higher alphabets, Ophanim and Nokian. This is the scene from the movie Stargate, and the letters here on the Stargate we now know are the Ophanim and Nokian letters here from the Ophanim and Nokian Sigil of Truth, five spins inside, seven spins outside, which is the slipknot of the Anu. And so if we look at the array of letters from the tablet of Nalvaj and the original angel names that John Dee did the scrying from the green stone, the show stone, which is still in the British Museum, you saw the plasma donuts in there, like we can see the plasma in the Therify. And Kelly then was able to sequence the plasma donuts and read off the letters. And this was the sequence. Zavkiel, Zadkiel, Kunael, Raphael, Haniel, Michael, Gabriel. So if you read the tablet of Nalvaj and the sequence of letter forms, the names of angels are just the sequence of symmetry arrays which hold plasma bodies together on an interstellar scale. And this was the 7x7 grid of the tablet of Nalvaj, and this became the high order angelic alphabet Ophanim and Nokian. And we have seen plasma storms the size of continents called with Ophanim and Nokian ritual, whether it is the tempest, which is the storm that took out the Spanish Armada. John Dee took years to fabricate that storm. He told Queen Elizabeth in advance. The meteorology came out of the sea. So the elementals know that we are drunk because we do not work with them. And the larger plasma elementals are the Ophanim and Nokian. And this is what Michael Sarian called them, the macrobes. And he thought John Dee was evil, but he didn't understand that actually it's necessary to deal with plasma beings the size of stars. So if you take vortex theory, the physics of embedding, and you dissect the embedded vortex, and you look at the components of the letter forms, that the different angles of the vortex become the alphabet of the Ophanim. And that's what this was about. This is Darlene's work with Vincent Bridges on the Ophanim and the great Ophanim letters. And that whole story is at goldenmean.info/Ophanim. The point is that the ability to become and relate to and have empathy for and understand the beingness of higher order plasma beings requires understanding the discipline of these symmetry arrays, and hence the need to understand what John Dee and Kelly were trying to do. It's sort of fun that, John Dee had the largest library on the in Europe, probably at the time, and was one of the most advanced mathematicians of his day, and after learning most of the languages of the planet, decided he wanted to speak with the angels. But one of his primary studies in mathematics was the mathematics of the hypercube. And later here, when Vincent Bridges analyzed the asymmetry of the arrangement of the Ophanim and Nokian letters in that tablet, a 16-cell, four-dimensional figure in a 4D octahedron, he called it a hypercube. So actually, the arrangement of the letters that became Ophanim and Nokian were hypercube, which is basically stellated tetra. So in a way, if you extend the vertex of tetra straight out, you have cube octa. And if you collapse that, remember we did this, you have icosa,
This is the jitterbug. And that was the physics of superconductivity when the molecules went from this to this, and this is how monoatomics work, and monoatomic carbon and gold powder. And then you continue that collapse, you have dodeca, here's a cube octa, icosa, dodeca. Dodeca is in there, and octa. And you finish the collapse, you have tetra. So if you stellate the seven arrows of the tetra, which is the cube of space, sevenarrows.net is our education or our attempt to recreate the science of using the seven arrows of space to inhabit, embed your space, shamanically to throw your weight around, become psychokinetic. And so this as stellated tetra is the hypercube. That's the point. There's the octa in the center. It's basically an unpacked cube, which is the same as a stellated tetra. So you take the Hebrew and you have a superset of that, which is hypercubic Ophanomenochian, in the same way that the dodecahedron is just a superset of a cube rotated. It's literally the next dimension, where in this case, next dimension always means only the ability to superpose the next order superposed axes of charge rotation symmetry, in the sense of rotating a cube into a dodecahedron, that you tilt the cube up 32 degrees, the chin angle sinks, and you rotate that cube and you fabricate a dodecahedron, which is to say, literally, quite literally, a fourth dimensional cube. So Vincent and I had an archetypal argument always saying that I would say that dodecahedron is actually the hypercube. You know, you unpack, you stellate a tetra to cube octa, and you can do that forever. You have only a tetracubic lattice seven arrows, and you have only powers of two octaves, and therefore you always be charge isolating. But then you jitterbug that to icosa dodeca, and then suddenly from hex to pent, and that's implosive, that's phase conjugate, that's negentropic. And so the climactic form of the hypercube, in my view, is the tetracube rotated into pent dodeca. Well, David, I'm glad you're here. Did I say jitterbug as in fusion theory? Well, what Nassim and I have agreed on is that if you track the trajectory, which is the jitterbug, if you track the golden mean spiral path from the tetracubic, pure octave, all powers of two edge length ratios of the cube octa tetracubic, if you track the trajectory of the node right there, when it went from cube octa to icosa, that trajectory is part of the golden mean spiral, which defines non-destructive charge collapse, which is the physics of why, when molecular arrays go from this to this, it is the onset of superconductivity, as in carbon nanotubes and also gold monofilaments, which are superconductors measurably, as is DNA. When you heat gold nanotube and you put some amperage through it at the moment of melting, it becomes a superconductor, just like DNA and carbon nano, because it contains a waveguide at the electron level for zero resistance, but also because in this geometry, onset of superconductivity, the definition of the possibility of superconductivity in our view is that the distance to center from every vertex in the icosa becomes an exponent of golden ratio. Never true here in cube octa, but always true in icosa dodeca. So the infinite 3D stellation, dodeca, icosa, the only possible three-dimensional fractal called star mother kit, goldenmean.info/kit. You see the inner dodeca in white, and then the icosa and the dodeca. And all you're doing is stellating straight out the faces of the dodeca, edges straight out to icosa, and then again edges straight out to the dodecaicosa. So the only possible three-dimensional fractal, definition of fractal field, which I then proved, is the radii of hydrogen by my new equation. So the possibility of phase conjugate golden ratio collapse through center defines the elimination of resistance called superconductivity. So superconductivity is always phase conjugate collapse through zero point at center, and therefore elimination of resistance. So perfecting charge distribution is perfecting charge collapse. In other words, once implosive phase conjugate negentropic centripetal force is generated, the waves always go through that Planck length and time
distance at center, the perfect black hole. The definition of the possibility of the black hole is phase conjugation, which is why that's the cause of gravity. It allows the waves that can make it then through that phase conjugate center point to be sorted. Remember, phase conjugation in optics is the first time physics ever knew negentropy was possible. And now we say phase conjugation is a cause of gravity. So when collapse is perfect through the heart of hydrogen, for example, golden ratio hydrogen radii for my new equation, that the center of hydrogen itself could become a sorting device. As example, hydrogen is the center of every DNA codon rung ladder bond. It's in psychological terms, when you're having this intense kundalini and your ears start to ring, you feel this lightning fire, tingling, burning increase inside. You can stand that collapse for just so long. It stresses the mineral to water bonds in your body. Your ears start to ring and you begin to have visions. And kundalini is normally diagnosed as schizophrenia until you understand the physics and you can understand how it is that all these voices inside are you, and you do not need to call yourself schizophrenic, because instead you know how to sort those voices. So yes, exactly, ancestral telephone calls, that's exactly what I'm talking about. That this is the ancestor speaking, and that if you're able to set your intent and focus enough to sort that many voices. So actually, bliss process, like the hero in the movie Powder having his lightning experience, is about learning to inhabit the center of a lightning bolt. And you do it gradually so that you begin to see that you can sort that many radio stations at once. And you do it because you're able to navigate the center of the tornado with your intent exactly. So non-destructive collapse, phase conjugate collapse, and the physics of the bliss and the origin of the Djedi story, the raising of the Djedi, that's what this was about. And let's see, we have just a few minutes to go from the lecture portion, and we have the few minutes of slides to go here. This was the emerald tablets of Thoth the Atlantean. You see the Thoth Tehuti and the Caduceus was the Cadistu here. And the emerald tablets actually become, here is the Bonpo Tibetan alphabet from their creation myth. Not only do you see the swastika here, but you actually see the physics of our animation, of the physics of the origin of the Holy Grail, you know, the golden spiral that rotates. goldenmean.info/grail. So here is the Bonpo master saying, light this inner fire by seeing the physics of the perfect flame called the bonfire. Remember, the Bonpo master is fabricating this huge moxibustion flame on the planet that lasts for weeks in a snowstorm in Calgary. thanks to Terry Willard for sharing his work with Christopher Hansard on this. And what the Bonpo are doing in fabricating a flame with their mind, the same way the Cherokee do, is they're acting on this inner discipline to focus the plasma very accurately using these ancient waveguides, the emerald tablets, the Bonpo, the bonfire, the inner flame. The Cherokee and the Bonpo only recognize and initiate after they can light a flame with their mind, which is to say become a Djedi, which is to say be able to steer the plasma by creating a low pressure point. And so the alphabet of the emerald tablets of Thoth the Atlantean again become plasma physics. And this is Thoth, and this is the plasma physics, and that's the Slipknot. And this becomes our study of bioactive field, which is the hermetic science and bioactivefield.com. And we have other courses in our series on that. So actually, we haven't done a very good job of doing the galactic history story. We've only touched on the highlights. I do recommend particularly The Secret of the Dark Stars, the English version by Anton Parks, because you can see why
The ancestors were those, the high ancestors, the ancestors worth listening to, the deepest whispering in your inner ear when you hear this ringing, will be the secret of the dark stars, because our plasma ancestors were inhabitors of the black holes, the dark stars. So all this fascination with Nassim and understanding the physics of what is a black hole. Some people say an electron is a black hole. Some people say a proton is a black hole, Nassim, for example. And some people say you can inhabit black holes. And some people say you can become the wormhole and you can steer Deep Space Nine. Well, it actually boils down to understanding the reality is the universe is 99.99% plasma, charge, clouds of charge. And what we call mass is, which is when the plasma charge gets into these little slipknots. So ultimately, your raiment, your gown, your garment in heaven, as it were, is going to be a plasma cloud. And your ability to attract and steer that plasma cloud coherently is absolutely your immortal body. That is your Jedi Knight, and that is your shamanic projection, your ability to raise the Jed and steer the Shem. And so that's the story to our Mori, is that the genetic disaster described in Draco history called Nephilim, meaning the fallen ones, the Asuras, the Asa Uru, the genetic disaster of Nephilim was, symptoms were loss of long-term memory, loss of ability to take memory through death, loss of ability to lucid dream, and in part, the ability to lucid dream was identical to with what was called Guild Navigator in Dune, which were those whose plasma cloud was so coherent they would be immersed in a liquid vat of what is effectively a gold powder liquid, and their aura becomes so projective that they could use it to leverage and steer the magnetic bubble inertially faster than the speed of light. And this is reflected when Charlie the Draco was abducting human teenagers to steer the time chair at Montauk. And we knew some of those people, knew Preston Nichols very well, knew Al Bielek very well, Michael Ash, who steered the time chair at Montauk. I had many good conversations with him. It was clear. In advance, they could predict who would have the phase coherence to steer the time chair. They called it a time empath. And the reason they called the one who steered the time chair at Montauk a time empath was simple. The ability to embed, ability to feel for those whom you are seeing empathically. It is your empathy ultimately that draws the future to you. Visualize Nostradamus sitting in the middle of a giant magnetic pentagram with the Magdalen sites in his tower, and he's looking in this piezoelectrically phase conjugate water doped with a phase conjugate optical coating on the bottom of the water cup, and he's scrying, and he's imploding the charge, and extreme stillness, and now Nostradamus, Our Lady, he is weeping, he is crying for the pain of those whom he's seeing in the future, and his empathy was what sucked the future into his body. His ability, this is what Gurdjieff called a feeling body. It's why when Gurdjieff said, you cannot start your study of the sacred gymnastic until you can put feeling in your baby finger. What did he mean? First, we thought he meant if when you put your attention in your little finger, you feel your baby fingers start to tingle. And the more you focus there, you realize that the tingling in your baby finger is increasing. And now you're recognizing the electrical inertia of the creation of the still point electrically phase conjugate, which is called your attention.
So as the electrical inertia and the phase conjugate coherence of your attention increases, then when you put your attention into your baby finger, the amount by which it starts to tingle and get warm increases. And that means the electrical inertia of your attention as a spin gradient to a zero point is increasing. And until you could put your finger in your attention in your baby finger to cause it to tingle, you weren't ready to learn sacred gymnastic, the sacred gymnastic. Because during the sacred gymnastic, you're taking your attention, which is the steering of this plasma field, and making a collective plasma bliss field. Why the climax scene from Meetings with Remarkable Men had so much biologic plasma in the bliss dance of the Gurdjieff gymnastic that it burnt into the celluloid of the film, you know? Robert Rivard said, Wayne says, we're not crazy at all. In fact, we are thriving by imploding and embedding. Exactly. To thrive is to implode and embed. That's to add inertia to your aura effectively. So eventually, you'll begin to steer the sun with the same centripetal electric inertia by which you created a tingling in your baby finger. So start with your baby finger. Can you hold your attention there long enough? Cause it to tingle, and eventually you will steer tornadoes with that low pressure point. Robert Rivard says, Grimville Melchizedek tells a story involving Al Bielek having no feelings or empathy. Does traveling in a metal flying saucer through time damage one's plasma field? Well, I believe I knew Al very well, and I actually thought he had pretty good empathy. But Duncan, who also did the time thing at Montauk with Al Bielek, kind of fell in love with my former girlfriend Susan Ambrose in Colorado, and she was afraid of him. She felt he was damaged for similar reasons that you say. But I do think most of the soldiers at in Montauk, Philadelphia, who returned, you know, kind of scrambled eggs and stuck in the hull of the ship, in fact, their DNA was not coherent enough to be imploded and accelerated. And that's why you spectrum analyze the DNA ahead of time and find out if it's phase coherent and phase conjugate, boson 7, microcoridians in the blood. And you know in advance who can lucid dream and time travel. In effect, this means that if you've been able to sustain bliss process repeatedly, eventually your DNA becomes much more phase coherent and therefore charge collapse called time travel. Because charge collapse is, non-destructive charge collapse is charge acceleration. And that defines time travel, which is what a longitudinal wave is. And so the ability to do non-destructive collapse, also known as successful death, requires extreme phase coherence in the DNA. So basically, the short story is, you need to be able to get a lot of bliss process handled, which means sorting your emotions, being ready for death, being ready for lucid dreaming, before you can do time travel very well. And I think this was reflected pretty well when Billy Myers said, you know, well, the Palladians could beam me up one way if I was emotionally coherent that day, but if I wasn't emotionally coherent, then they had to beam him up in a very uncomfortable way, or much more mechanically. So a coherent aura is clearly required for transposition of vorticity implosion, which I think is the definition of the term L as in Elohim, non-destructive charge collapse, or optimized translation of vorticity. Literally, with the implosion, accelerating through the speed of light and into time only happens in DNA that's through long evolution of bliss process gets to be that level of phase coherence. May the force be with you, Luke. You know, the teacher is the one who can. Lisa says, it seems the massive amount of gold extracted from the earth is out of proportion to the few number of ETs here using it for their DNA in the form of monoatomic gold. I do think that is an issue that, you know, the aboriginals and the natives believe the gold needed to stay in the ground because it was containing the radioactives. And in fact, gold in the earth helps atmosphere maintenance because it makes our atmosphere more phase conjugate. So Sitchin got part of it right, that Draco came to mine the gold to fix the atmosphere on home planet. What they didn't understand was that the gold tends to form where magnetic lines cross in a fractal pentadodecahedron.
hence the dousing of magnetic lines to predict where gold will form at conjugate points in the grid, but also then the presence of that gold in the planet natively helps to sustain the phase conjugate Schumann harmonics and thus atmosphere maintenance. So basically anything that makes the Earth and its atmosphere electrically centripetal assists not just with atmosphere maintenance, but the maintenance of life. So removing vast amounts of gold can be very hazardous to the negentropy of Gaia. And you're right, the other simple part of that joke is, hey, Mr. Sitchin, not only were they mining the gold to fix their home atmosphere, but they were eating it. most of the gold on the planet is in the oceans. Thank you, Thomas. Yes, so the monatomic form of the gold is actually dissolved in the ocean. That's good. And David Pukta is with us, and he's working on what he calls protonspintechnology.com, and he's suggesting to take a look. We're very interested, David. We're happy to look at that and to try to understand more about that. I'm sure it would be fascinating and maybe has relationships to Nassim's work on proton radius and Mark's new work on the proton to electron mass being pure geometry, which predicts, in his view, that phase conjugation is in fact the cause of gravity. And all of that conversation, which I'd love to compare with your work, is at fractalfield.com/conjugategravity. So let's have that conversation and pursue that, David. I look forward to it. Maybe we'll get to have a chat tomorrow. Sounds like fun. Thomas Geckler says, so is the Therify a time machine portal? Well, actually, Sarah, who is the shaman from sevenarrows.net, had clear shamanic portal kinds of experiences in the Therify. That's clear. So, you know, the Therify as it is a bit of a time portal. And we could increase the array, increase the voltage, increase the number of tubes, and absolutely make what the ancients called a dirana. A dirana is, according to Anton Parks, the Sumerian term for stargate. And it means more than just a stargate or a spaceport, because he says, in general, most of the wars break out over the stargate, the dirana. And what he means by that is humans are, and their Draco ancestors, are all unconsciously aware that you're basically toast if you're stuck on a planet, and you need to get your plasma accelerated and back into star inhabiting. And to do that, the collective lucid dreaming pod needs to do their bliss process collectively together in these places, which were Amenti Amarna or Uru Asa Elim, Jerusalem, which are Stargate, Dirana. And there would be wars because access to the Stargate is like people fighting to get in the airport. The thing about having a war over Jerusalem, though, I think we should cancel that war because the Stargate's broken. It would be better to build one that works. It's broken because it's misaligned now, and it no longer functions for proper plasma acceleration. So we need to do the work to understand what a Dirana is, and then understand how the advanced beings whose aura is coherent can use that to plasma project back out through the heart of our star. Remember, the heart of the sun is the only thing with the inertial escape velocity necessary, basically, to get in and out of the solar system. So going through the sun into the other more advanced is step one, hence Anu or sun god. And David Pukta says, shows the scalar waves. Yes, we're suggesting that phase conjugation is the primary way in which longitudinal waves are created electromagnetically, and that longitudinal electromagnetics is perhaps a better definition of what was called scalar or torsional. And David says, yes, I approve it. Superconductivity is a phase angle from impedance to resistance. It would have to do with phase angle. A phase conjugate phase angle would produce non-destructive collapse. And yes, the issue of phase angle is the issue of zero-point energy superconductively from the vacuum. And that's where our current energy project, implosionamp.com, starts with realizing that the cachet device is basically a power factor corrector, which is how they label it on their own graphic. And we realize the connection of a partially superconductive coil due to its monatomic in series and parallel with a resonant tank circuit with capacitance makes it, it's called parametric amplification. That is to say, if you have two resonators and they resonate together recursively, you get the phenomenon called phase conjugate parametric amplification, which is basically a tank circuit that implodes, a variation on the theme of the Tom Bearden Meg. And so when the resonance is recursive, the recursive resonance makes this field effect, again, that looks like pine cones kissing noses, and that implosion of plasma in the charge envelope of the parametric amplification makes parametric amplification that's over unity, literally a vacuum coherence zero-point energy device. And we actually have the literature showing that over unity parametric amplification is optimized by phase conjugation. And so we have a group of engineers that are meeting regularly on that project, and it's a funded project, and we have support. It's wonderful, with Evans there, who was Keshe's original engineer from China. And we have Chris, who's the fabulous professor of engineering there in Belgium, and Mark, our engineer from Phoenix, and Paul, our engineer for Therify. So that team is progressing well on the parametric amplification implosion amp, which is a variation on the theme of the Bedini over-unity battery charger, which is also a prototype that team is working on. And it's all about implosion. There's lots of ways to do it. It's true that Keshe, unfortunately, David is saying Keshe doesn't have a clue. You know, Keshe's background clearly is nuclear engineering, and his electrical engineering is sadly shallow, probably. And so he's not able to express that language very well. But he did have some useful intuitions about monoatomics. Gareth is saying, would be pleased to hear more about the ET history and the Dracos. Well, you know, it would get to a point in our lives where every time we see that, you know, like the oxygen is going down in our cars in our cities, we say, well, it's an insidious Draco plot, and everything is a Draco plot. Well, you know, it's sort of like the scene from the comic strip where he says, what was the comic? He said, we have met. Oh, yes, Pogo. We have met and encountered the enemy, and it is us. You know, our Draco ancestors are basically here, and they're with us, and they got troubles, and so do we. And we can see it as a Draco plot, or we can see it as a failure to educate. And I see it as a failure to educate, actually, that functionally, we do have these massive problems with our civilization, but they all come down to human behavior, and human behavior ultimately comes down to education. And when people learn to reprioritize their whole life to be basically the maintenance of the possibility of bliss, to become the Jedi Knight, religion wars disappear, priorities among governments suddenly produce total agreement. In fact, the possibility of there being collective agreement on anything becomes possible when you agree on what are people for. And I think we've done a pretty good case right here, right now, of saying what people are for. We can make the plasma centripetal that makes Earth self-regulating, that steers tornadoes, inhabits stars, and projects our plasma back into the Jedi story. And it's all good science. And so I think if we share this idea of what people are for, we could reinvent government. And it doesn't require revolution. It requires education. Thank you, Kevin. Thank you for that. Eden Grace said, what are the ancestors and Kadistu now, and what are they doing? I think the Kadistu, which were called the Life Designers, which Vincent Bridges called the Galactic Core Cultures, and there's a section on galactic history there in the Fusion of Blood article. I think they are doing what was later called the Hermetic Agenda. And I would call this course series, fractalu.com, Hermetic Agenda. The Hermetic Agenda is A, recognize what a bioactive field is, teach it, and make it with your life, with your architecture, with your food, with your clothing, bioactivefield.com. That is a Hermetic Agenda, and that is a caduceus, and that is the origin of the word Kadistu. So I think we are doing that work right here This is what Hermes would have us do right here, right now. Teach the science of what life force is to our kids. And by the way, that will tell them how to have a bliss experience. And I feel that the skill to teach your teenagers to have a bliss experience defines whether you have culture. We've said that many times. And I think that's what our ancestors are. And I think that's what our ancestral voices whispering our ears, survival, 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 are trying to tell us to get immortal. Okay, David says, what you're trying to say is implosion is correct. However, in the Meissner field, takes up in the void. It pulls an EMF. You cannot walk up to any claim circuit. Throws that EMF. It's not superconducting. Yes, there's a very interesting conversation about Meissner field, and I think the Meissner field idea is related to what Lawrence Gardner was talking about in his book, The Sacred Arc, where he says the infinitely unpacked, what I call phase conjugate electric field around monoatomic gold powder, what the ancients called the planes of Charon, literally an infinite electric field. Look, when the field is phase conjugate fractal, the electric field around the gold powder unpacks it. It's a very huge aura. And I think, which Lawrence Gardner says, is the origin of the term planes of Charon. The word for heaven in the ancient Hebrew, which we now call hey abe, breath of charge taking flight, is a name for this perfectly unpacked electric field. And I think this relates greatly to this conversation about what is a Meissner field. And I would love to pursue that in future conversations. Sarah says, can you talk about bloodlines in respect to blood types? Well, you know, it's the ancient cliche, but we think that, Lawrence Gardner says Britain means Beret-an, which is a birthplace of the Anunnaki, as in Bereshin, or Bethlehem, meaning the container of, or birthplace of. So Britain, Beret-an, that there was a high content of the Draco Anu Anunnaki blood in Britain, the Highlander story, and which is to say the New Jerusalem, and there's all these wonderful stories about Jerusalem actually being in Britain, you know, that's a whole other story. The Michael line, Mikael, which is to say, another way of saying that is being the largest concentration, more in the past than now, the largest concentration on the planet of Rh negative blood in the UK. What did that mean? Rh negative means the rhesus monkey is absent. Anki starts with the rhesus monkey, mixes this with a reptilian, but now where the rhesus monkey is absent, Anki's work is not so present. And in Rh negative blood, you have a stiff upper lip. You have a dominance of the reptilian. And this is cliche, and it's superficial, and it's genetic stereotyping. But there might be something useful here just to say that clearly a stiff upper lip does occur if mother says don't cry when you're a little boy. That's simple physics. And how they talk in the House of Lords with a stiff upper lip. And also, you know, we only hug our dogs and horses. So we know that if you want a hug, you're much more likely to get it in Italy than in England. So this is the stereotype about Rh negative blood, and it's only a stereotype. But it does tell you something, that the reptilian blood, Draco and reptilian, and there's a little bit of a difference, but it's basically Draco and reptilian blood, was less able to have passion, but more able to have psychokinesis. And more able to have telepathy, let's be clear. Whereas the monkey blood, there was the passion. And the Rh negative has less of rhesus monkey, so there's less passion. let's not pick on the stiff upper lip. There's a lot of value to be English, the Anglish there. But this was an example of perhaps a cliche conversation about, you know, where the bloodlines branched. And clearly we did get passion from the monkey. We didn't get it from the... So the reptilian brain is not the source of the bird brain. You have the bird brain and the reptilian brain. And this is the bird brain, Ibi, and this is the Uri. This is the reptilian, the snake brain, which is the amygdala. Prove this part. When the ball spins in the coil, reading Mark, the ball is itself spinning with gravitational magnet. If you heat the magnet towards
Meissner field, interesting. Yes. So, David, let's pursue that conversation. Maybe we do an article together. Yes, about the superconductive and the Meissner field and rotation. Yes, yes. But let me think. Have we finished the story about the bloodlines? So, ultimately, the meaning of the Grail bloodline, which we've talked many times about at goldenmean.info/grail, is just that. When the braiding algorithm becomes recursive in the DNA in response to bliss, literally the relationship of the short wave to the long wave, and the longer wave yet, seven times, embedding in braiding in DNA, responding to the phonon wave of heart coherence, brain phase conjugation, long wave human bliss. Long wave human bliss is a phonon phenomena, long wave sound. Benthoff proved it when he proved the ringing heard in the ears of meditators, sang Grail, song in the blood, the ventricle liquids in the ear ring, and he measured those frequencies, and the harmonics of the ringing in the ear meditators and Kundalini experiencers hear. The chart is in my book, new book, from Benthoff, showing that the frequencies are a phase conjugate pump wave, exactly like the low frequencies of the spine liquid pump and the Meyer wave all fit my equation for implosive phase conjugate. So this means that the Grail in the blood is literally when the blood absorbs all of that imploding charge and then becomes psychokinesis. And that's the real meaning of the Holy Grail in the blood. And that's the sort of story to the Mori of 10 years of doing tours of South France teaching the science of the Grail mysteries. You know, it's fun to run about to find sacred sites, but ultimately it's about sitting in one place and having your charge implode your blood and to be able to have a bliss experience. And that's the real meaning of the Holy Grail. And the Da Vinci Code was right. You know, it was a bloodline. It was the story of the lineage of Mary. It was, you know, the Black Madonna becomes Trophimius John, who melts his coffin lid with his plasma aura, and that becomes the Grail platen, that stone, the same way that Samuel Padmasambhava melted the stone in India with his palm print still there melted in the stone. So this ability to get a highly charged plasma aura is the story of the Grail in the blood. Oh, and David is speaking about George Merkel's library. Yes, we didn't talk about that. George Merkel, we had some wonderful conversations with him. George Merkel was talking about Sumerian elixirs, and he said basically that if you look at the shape of subcellular organelles, you find the shape of the ancient Sumerian letters. And the ancient Sumerian letters were the fact that Enki and his crew were focusing coherent light through these waveguides called Sumerian letters to fabricate subcellular organelles, Sumerian elixirs. In other words, not just Hebrew and Sanskrit are a genetic engineering software symmetry environment, but the Sumerian letters themselves are optical waveforms for fabricating biologic structures. David, I'm really glad that you like George Merkel's work. So did I. Is Chondriana and Sumerian elixirs, and Adam Trombley was working with him with his health problems as well. That's a long story. Yeah, we should have fun with that. We'll tell that story another time. But I see that it's about 10:30 p.m. here, and my voice is running out. Last questions. Oh, yeah, the solfeggio scale of John the Baptist and the related frequencies. You know, we did a pretty good analysis of the solfeggio scale Daniel Bush. Oh, I'll think of the link later. But so basically, the solfeggio scale came down to a golden ratio progression. That was the simple science of it. So it's sort of like the modulus of architecture from
What was it, the modulus of it, solfeggio is just basically a way to approach a golden ratio cascade. And so basically it was an introduction to phase conjugate tuning. That was, I know, Daniel Boorish. In fact, let me see if I can get the link right here. I'll put it in here. The analysis we did, yeah. Here's the web article. So Daniel Boorish was analyzing the solfeggio work. And so we did a discussion with him. And that's the link on that. It's suggesting again that solfeggio was an introduction to the golden ratio cascade, which is then basically an introduction to how to phase conjugate and be negentropic. John Wong says, what is the star mother kit and what is it used for? Well, this is the star mother kit, originally called Greater Maze at Theosophy, dodecicosa, the only possible three-dimensional fractal, recently, which we proved was the geometry of hydrogen, DNA, Earth grid, zodiac, Ezekiel's wheels, Merkaba, all that good stuff. Star Mother Kit is at goldenmean.info/kit. And it's a beautiful way and discipline to build that, you know, it starts with star tetracube, a red in the center, and then you embed that cube here in this golden ratio dodecahedron here, and you stellate dodeca decosa and ecosa dodeca, and you see that the dodeca ecosa dodeca three-dimensional fractal could extend infinitely and thus be a model of perfect three-dimensional waveform collapse, which I say is not just literally exactly the geometry of hydrogen from my new equation, but also the geometry of monatomics, essentially with the SPDF subshells completed and noble, and also monatomic gold, monatomic carbon, and fullerene, exactly that geometry. So it's a very useful way to build and meditate. And by the way, if you put capacitors at the nodes at the right phase conjugate distances, instead of zoom tool balls, you would have a zero-point energy device. Thank you, and thank you for the link, David, and it's after 10:30, and we're about to say goodnight here. Thanks, everybody, for joining us. Remember, the storal to the mori is... follow your bliss. I mean, light the fire in your blood. I mean, become a Jedi warrior. So that's the happily ever after. Thank you. Blessings. Sweet dreams. Thanks for coming, everybody. Bye. Have a great night. And we will share this at fractalfield.com/fusioninTheBlood. Blessings and happy new year. Bye-bye.